shall rise up to pray. Our great God in heaven, we thank you for another Bible study tonight. Thank you for the effect and the impact of all that we studied in your word. Thank you, Lord, because you are granting us your grace and strength and power of the Spirit so we can carry out what you are teaching us. We pray, oh Lord, as we come for another session today, that you will bless your people. Amen. You lead us more into your will, in your word, in Jesus' name. Amen. And we pray, Lord, that as a result of obedience to your word, your church will grow. Amen. The kingdom will be enlarged. And great will be the rewards of your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you very much. You can be seated. Matthew chapter 28, verse 18, verse 19, verse 20. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. And everybody said,
Amen.
Amen. Now, those words of Jesus Christ are not new to the majority of us. That's what is called the Great Commission. It's a commission, and it's very, very great. It's great in all its meaning, all its interpretation, all its application, all its implication, all its ramifications. If you look at verse 19, go ye therefore, go ye therefore. Why is the therefore there in verse 18? And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. As a result, as a consequence of all power being given unto the Lord Jesus Christ, and we've been associated with him, identified with him, it says, therefore, because all power belongs to me, and this is the reason Christ speaking to us, it says, go ye therefore and teach all nations. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. That was it's called evangelism. But then you look at verse 20. Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. That's the follow-up part of the Great Commission. One, you evangelize, and two, you follow up the people and bring them to the knowledge, the full knowledge of the fullness of the gospel. Let's come to Mark chapter 16. In Mark chapter 16, reading from verse 15, and he said unto them, go ye into the world and preach the gospel to every creature. That's the evangelism. And then in verse 16, we're told, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. You preach to every creature. You preach to a multitude. Out of that multitude, the Lord will call unto himself the people that are repenting and that yielding, giving themselves to the Lord. When they give themselves to the Lord, believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, it says we're to baptize them in water. After that baptism, we continue to teach them all things whatsoever the Lord has commanded us. As we come back to Matthew chapter 28, and you're looking at those two verses together, verses 19 and 20. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. That's the area of evangelism. Go evangelize. Go witness to them. Go tell them the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ who died for them so that they can come to the Lord. After that evangelism, that's not the end. Baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. That means we're going to do another thing. Number two, you're enlightening them. Number one, you evangelize them. After evangelizing them, you don't leave them there on the field. Do they believe on the Lord Jesus Christ? Enlighten them. That means educate them. There's still something that follows. When you have given your life to the Lord, you need to be baptized in water. Why? Because it's a commandment of the Lord. You baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. If the Lord has called us to evangelize, he has also called us to enlighten and to educate. Number three is to encourage them to endure. Encourage them to endure. You see, in those olden days, whenever they were baptized in water, they understood it's a public identification with the body of Christ. It's a public identification with Christ himself. And of course, the unbelieving people are going to see that. And as a result of that, persecution may come. Because that public identification with the Lord Jesus Christ and with the body of believers will expose them to the public knowing. Now they are believed on the Lord and persecution may come. That's why you have number three. You encourage them to endure. And you remind them the words of Jesus Christ. He that endures to the end, the same shall be saved. And then after they have been baptized in water, now they are to be integrated into the church. How do you integrate them into the church? Number four, enlist them, enroll them. Enlist them, enroll them. It's like, you know, a child has gone to school and the name enters the register. And now we know that this child belongs to this class. And every time the teacher comes there to that class, he expects to find this boy. He expects to find this girl. That's why he'll bring out the register. And he wants to see all these young people that are enrolled in the school and enrolled in the class. He has enlisted them. He has listed them out. And then before he starts anything, he says, Mary, yes, ma'am. John, yes, madam. And Joseph, yes, I'm here. He calls the roll. And that's what the Lord is telling us to do. We've gone out, we've evangelized them. And then we enlighten them, we educate them. We encourage them to endure. Now they must become part of the church. And becoming part of the church means enrollment. And it means we're enlisting them as part of the people of God. Now, first to go to follow up. That means everybody virtually. That means all the children of God, all the Christians, you are giving them exhortation. And as you give them exhortation, they'll be watching you. You tell me, when grace comes into our lives, grace is going to make a change. And grace is going to turn us around. And grace is going to bring the character of Christ into our lives. Number five now, exemplify your exhortation. You're exhorting them. You are instructing them. You are telling them, here is the way a child of God behaves. Here is the way a child of God will live. Here is how we maintain a relationship with the Lord, relationship with one another, integration relationship with the church. You exemplify what you are exhorting them to do, what you are exhorting them to practice, what you are telling them. And then number six, edify them. Every time you go to follow up, you are visiting them. You ask yourself, what does this new convert need? What does this new convert need to bring him up, lift him up, and help him to stand on his two feet on this new faith? And because you are thinking of that, what am I going to do? What am I going to say that will make a positive impact in his life? You are talking about edification. What can I teach? How can I instruct? And how can I present everything it will bring for the edification? Number six, edify them. Number seven, engage them. Engage them. They need to get involved. That's how we ourselves were brought up. That's how we ourselves were lifted up. And then what we're able to do, we're now able to do what we're doing today. Remember, number one, evangelize. Number two, enlighten, educate. Number three, encourage them to endure whatever persecution, whatever trial, and whatever the consequence of their believing on the Lord Jesus Christ now, encourage them to endure. Number four, enlist them, enroll them. They must become part of the church of the living God. Number five, exemplify your exhortation. Be a good example to them, an excellent example to them. Number six, edify. Number seven, engage. Actually, that's how they did it in the early church. If you look at Acts of the Apostles, chapter 15. Acts, chapter 15. I'm reading from verse 36. Acts 15, verse 36. And some days after, Paul said unto Barnabas, let us go again and visit our brethren in every city where we have preached the word of the Lord and see how they do. And have you noticed what Paul was saying in that verse? Paul and Barnabas had gone out to preach. They went to the regions beyond. That is the people that didn't know the Lord before. As a result of going to them, many of them believed. That's why they became brothers and sisters. And those brothers and sisters are referred to as brethren. Look at that verse 36. And some days after, they had gone out, they had evangelized, they had come back to the home church. And now, Paul the apostle said, Barnabas, we cannot remain here. Like all the other people, we have new converts. We are babes in Christ. Let us go therefore and visit our brethren in every city where we have preached the word of the Lord. Why are you doing that? And see how they do. And see how they are going on with the Lord. That's what we call visitation and follow-up. And it's a ministry. Everyone that has the ministry of evangelism must also have the ministry of this visitation and follow-up. This follow-up is the soul winner's effort. Serving, maturing, integrating the fruits of evangelism into the local church. The great commission given by the Lord Jesus Christ is so clear. And you've seen it already in the two sides. One side, evangelize, and the other side, enlighten, encourage, enlist, exemplify, edify, and engage, integrate them to the body of Christ. All these areas were referred to as the follower, and is getting acquainted with the new convert, and seeing to their spiritual growth and usefulness. And before we can do that, we must visit. That's why it says, in that verse 36, let us go again. We've gone before. That's to evangelize. Let's go again now. That's to enlist, to edify, and to help them to really stand on their feet and visit our brethren in every place where we have gone, preaching the word of God. Evangelists must do this. Pastors must do this. Workers, leaders must do this. Christian people must do this as well. What's the result of such a thing? Number one, it will give us strong, steadfast believers. If you follow up and you do not leave the people just to find their own way or to find their feet, when you follow up on those new converts, it will make them strong, make them steadfast believers. Number two, it will give us steady growth of those converts. Those converts will be growing steadily. And they will be growing up in the things of the Lord. Number three, it will also bring fervent commitment to evangelism in the local church. Number four, it will also mean the prevention of backsliding. The prevention of backsliding. That's how they did it in the early church. And that's what the Lord is calling us to do. We ought to do it as well. I divide the message today to three parts. Number one, the purpose. Number two, the practice. Number three, the profit. Number one, the purpose of follow-up and visitation. The purpose of follow-up and visitation. Number two, the practice of follow-up and visitation. The practice, it was done in the early church, and we need to continue doing it too. Number three, the profit of follow-up and visitation. I pray you'll do it well. Amen. We're coming to number one, the purpose of follow-up and visitation. Acts chapter 15 again, verse 36. And some days after, that means we shouldn't allow the period between the evangelization and the follow-up to be too far apart. Some days after, not some months after, not some years after, some days after. If you have gone out and you have evangelized, you have knocked on doors, you presented the gospel to the people, and the people have yielded, they have surrendered themselves to the Lord, then you come back home some days after. although you still carry on evangelism towards the people who have not believed on the Lord, towards other people, yet you must go back again to the people, to the places where you have gone before. And you know, sometimes we're so eager to go and evangelize and go to the regions beyond that we don't go back again to the places where we have been before. And the Lord is saying, go back there. Go back to those same places. You know, there are people that use a slogan, nobody has the right to hear twice when others have not heard once. That slogan did not come from the Bible, because Jesus Christ obviously did not walk by that kind of slogan. Not right for other anybody to hear twice when others have not heard once. Do you remember that Jesus Christ kept on teaching his own disciples? They've heard once, he taught them again, he taught them again, he taught them again, when others have not heard. And here Paul the apostle is saying, we've gone there before, they've heard it once, let's go back there again. What if you saw me going to the same stage all over again? Or you say, Pastor, you've been there once this year, and the other stage you have not gone. Yes, I know, let's go there again. But Pastor, don't you remember, it's not right for any state to have you two times when other states have not heard once. I don't know where that is coming from. Because Paul the apostle said, let us go again to the places we have gone. You see, follow-up is very necessary. We want to see how they are doing. We want to see how they are responding. We want to see the impact and the result of what we did before. That will help us in going to a new state, or going to a new region, or going to a new locality. We'll be able to say, okay, the method we used in that place is working. Because when we go back there, we see the result. We see the follow-up. We see the response of the people. We see the growth of the church. And we see the impact on that community. That then we say, we cannot go to a new region, go to a new place, and try exactly the same thing. Because what we did the other time there is actually working. We've gone back there, and we have seen the result. We can go and duplicate it, reproduce it in another place. Come back to that verse 36. Some days after, Paul said unto Barnabas, let us go again and visit our brethren in every city where we have preached the word of the Lord, and see how they do. That's follow up. And that's what the Lord is calling us to. And I'm so glad we're making up our minds we're going to do it. In Acts chapter 18. Acts chapter 18, verse 22. Acts 18, verse 22. And when he had landed at Caesarea and gone up and saluted the church, he went down to Antioch. And after he had spent some time there, he departed and he went over all the country of Galatia and Phrygia in order, strengthening all the disciples. Why was he doing that? He was strengthening them. That's the purpose of follow-up. You are going there so that those converts can be strengthened. Do you know how weak a baby may be? And do you know that's why the mother will concentrate on that baby, feed the baby, fellowship with the baby, help the baby to grow up, strengthen the baby. Don't you know that's what we do in follow-up? Now they are new babes in Christ. Feed them with the word of God. Those new converts don't know where to read in the Bible. Look at all these books of the Bible. Where do they start? And look at the English of the Bible. It's not the present day English for most of the Bibles, whether King James Version or any other version. Therefore, they need somebody to help them understand, and they need somebody to bring out the word of God that will feed their soul and strengthen them. That's exactly what Paul the apostle did. We're told they went to this place and that place in order, one after the other, strengthening all the disciples. We're looking at John chapter 21 and see how Jesus Christ himself did this. Because what he's telling us to do, he himself had done. And he wants us to carry it on. I'm reading John chapter 21 verse 14. In John 21 verse 14, this is now the third time that Jesus showed himself to his disciples after that he was risen from the dead. Wait a moment. many times the Lord Jesus said, I will die, I'll be killed, but on the third day I will rise again. It actually happened the way he said it. He died for our salvation. He was raised up for our justification. And then he appeared to his own disciples. Do you see this verse 14? This is now the third time that Jesus showed himself to his disciples. Why was he doing that? He wanted to strengthen their faith. Their faith in him as their Lord, as their Messiah, as the Christ, as the Savior, and as the Master that has commanded them, go and tell other people too. Third time that he showed himself unto his disciples. Have you visited any of those converts three times? Look at Jesus. He rose from the dead and to strengthen them and to make them stand unshakable and to make them face the persecution waiting for them in the Acts of the Apostles. He appeared to them again. Look at John chapter 20. Since it mentions three times, let's look at the other times. Verse 19. John chapter 20, verse 19. In John 20, verse 19, then the same day at evening, when the first day, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and said unto them, peace be unto you. Why did he come to them at this time? Because they were fearful. They knew Christ rose from the dead, but they were locked behind the doors. Don't you know those new converts, babes in Christ, can be very, very fearful. What will my friends say? What will my parents say? What will my schoolmates say? What will my community say? And the people I've been running out together with, playing pranks and doing evil, I'm not doing that again. What are they going to say? And then they become fearful. They might lock themselves up. And then Jesus appeared unto them. What a wonderful thing it will be for you and those converts when they are fearful. At just at the right moment, you are there to strengthen them, to say, peace be unto you. In verse 20, and when he had so said, he showed unto them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. That's the consequence of follow-up, the result of follow-up. When you go to follow them up, they're just in the midst of persecution and they're fearful and they're considering, should I go on? Should I pull back? Should I stand? Should I fall? Should I keep on with this Christ and this new experience in Christ? Or do I give it up? And then you appear before them. You go to them. You visit them. And then you strengthen them. And while you're going to say, I'm very grateful to the Lord you came just at this time. How glad I am. And how grateful I am that this is the time you really came. Then you become very useful to them. But that was the first time. Let's look at verse 24. In verse 24, but Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. And the other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, except I see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger in the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. What if you go to those new converts and you don't meet them at home, and they just happen not to be there, like Thomas? What do? You go back there again. That's why now we're reading verse 26. And after 8 days, again, his disciples were with him, and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst, and said, peace be unto you. Then said he to Thomas, reach hither thy finger, behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand, and thrust it into my side. And be not faithless, but believing. And Thomas answered and said unto him, my Lord and my God. You see how direct the Lord Jesus Christ was in the follow-up, in the visitation. He went to visit them, and he made sure now Thomas was there. If you don't meet Thomas at home the first time in your follow-up program or system, go back there again. And then you see how Jesus Christ answered his question and really went to the point, because Thomas had said, except I see the hand, except I see that side, and thrust my hand in there, I will not believe. And Jesus said, Thomas, here is my hand, put your finger here. And here is my side, thrust your hand there. And then Thomas said, my Lord and my God. That was the second time. And now in chapter 21, verse 1. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias. And on this wise showed he himself. This is the third time now. Why did he go to them at this particular time? Look at verse 3. Simon Peter says unto them, I go a fishing. They say unto him, we also go with him. They went forth and entered into a ship immediately. And that night they caught nothing. Discouragement has set in. Because of the discouragement, Peter said, I go a fishing. And then the other disciples said, I will go with you too. Do you know that newcomers sometimes miss fellowship? Yes, they do. Do you know that newcomers sometimes get discouraged? Yes, they do. Do you know the tendency is there for the newcomers to go back to the net they dropped before? Yes, sometimes it happens. And do you know that those converts, if they're living in the same community, do you know they can influence one another? That one is going back, that one is going back, that one is going back. We go with you too. This a new experience, and this a Christ that is risen. We don't know about it. Let me take my fishing nets and go back again. And just at that time, Jesus appeared to them. If you are following up, the newcomers have gone there once, they've gone there the second time, and now after the second visitation, when they were very happy, they were very glad. You came, wonderful. And then Thomas said, my Lord and my God. Then after that second time, one of them said, I think I want to go back. What do you do? Do you get discouraged yourself? Now tell me, the new convert is discouraged, and the soul winner is discouraged. Discouragement plus discouragement will be equal to discouragement. Multiply discouragement. But you see, Jesus Christ was not discouraged. He went there the third time, and then he saw them in this predicament. That's why we now come back to verse 14. This now is the third time that Jesus showed himself to his disciples after he had risen from the dead. In verse 15, so when they had done, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? Well, but other people followed after Peter. Why is it that Jesus concentrated on Simon Peter? In our follow-up, we need to be very wise. You see, in follow-up, you see the people that are leaders over the people. What I mean is, this fellow is converted, this fellow is converted, and this other one is converted. But this one is like the mouthpiece of the rest of them. And whatever he says he wants to do, if he says, I don't think I want to follow Christ again, the other people will say, you strong fellow, if you are strong as this and you say you are not following, who am I? I am weak. I'm not as strong as you. If you are not following, I'm not following. Another person said, well, the persecution is so much. Naturally, you are bold. Naturally, you are very, very strong. And you are telling us that the persecution is too much. You're not going to follow. If you cannot stand, where will I stand? I too will not follow again. You see, Peter was an influencer. He influenced all the other people. I go a fishing, and then they went with him. And Jesus now went to visit them. He wanted to follow them up the third time. And then he centered his follow-up instruction on Peter, because he knew if I get Peter, he will influence the rest of them. And so here we are in verse 15. Simon Peter, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He says unto him, yes, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He says unto him, feed my lambs. You see, all these ones that you have influenced, I'm now commanding you, commissioning you, feed them, instruct them, help them. You know, if you will go to those people like Simon Peter And then you also visit the others, of course. Simon Peter, it will not take him time. He'll even help all the other people too. So I dare you, they can be strong in the Lord. The Lord is telling us that we actually need to do this follow-up, and we need to do it intelligently. We're looking at Romans chapter 1. In Romans chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 9. Romans chapter 1, verse 9. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers. Stop there for a moment. Don't run too fast. Now you see, when we're doing follow-up, we pray. You preach, yes, but you pray. You pray for the people before you go to preach to them. You reach and touch the throne of heaven on their behalf before you go to them and actually reach and touch them. You see, it is a prayer that will prepare your heart and a prayer that will prepare their heart and then link you together in that follow-up exercise. It says, God is my witness because I pray for you. I make mention of you in my prayers every time, always making requests by any means. Now, at length, I might have a prosperous journey by the will of God to come to you. He was also praying about his going to them. You see, why do you have to pray about something like that? Maybe you don't understand. The apostle was a very busy man. And as he was being called and being pulled here and there, he needs to be in Thessalonica. He needs to be in Colossae. He needs to be in Philippi. He needs to be in Antioch. He needs to be in Corinth. He needs to be in Galatia. He needs to be here and there. And yet, there's something telling him, Paul the apostle, you are doing much. But there's an incomplete schedule. Because Rome is still there, and you need to visit those people. He had to put all his schedule before the Lord to say, oh Lord, look at all this. I must be here, I must be here, I must be here. And there's a pool within me saying, I must be in Rome also. You see, when you're a busy man, a busy woman, a busy brother, a busy sister, you really need to pray that God will help you. All these cards have been given to you. And you have a lot of responsibility in the church, in your place of work, in your school, in your firm, in your corporation, and you have a lot you are doing. And yet, you know, every time you open your Bible, you see the way you put that card, and there's a pool within you. And then if you don't really reorganize yourself, rearrange your time, you're not going to be able to make it. Those people might go back to the world before you're able to reach them. Then you go on your knees and say, Lord, I need to pray. I need your help because I'm just too overloaded. And yet I must not miss these people. I must get to them. That's why Paul the apostle was praying and he was saying, Lord, the commitment is so much. The load is so much. And the places I need to touch, there's so many. And yet I am praying, you'll give me a prosperous journey unto these people in Rome. In verse 11, for I long to see you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift to the end ye may be established. The establishment of the converts. That's why we're reaching them. That's why we're following up on them. That's why we're visiting them. That's why we're going to them, that ye may be established. Well, you then, as a Christian, as a child of God, here is what the Lord has called you to do. That these new converts, like newborn babes, because they're ignorant, because they're limited in their understanding, and because they can be easily confused and they are beset with temptations and persecution, they don't have experience in the word of righteousness. That's the reason why you need to rise up as a brother, as a sister, a soul winner, a worker, a leader, and reach out to them. You become like a mother, you become like a father, and it is your duty to nourish and to nurture those young converts through those initial stages of the Christian race until they're able to stand and stand alone. In fact, how do we summarize what you do? Now you've made up your mind, you know, you must follow up. You must go to them. What's the purpose? What are you going to do? Number two, instruct. Instruct. Instructing them. It says in Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6. Proverbs 22, verse 6. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. when people, first of all, when they come to the Lord, they are babes in Christ. And that's the time for you to nurture them, train them in the way they should go, so that when they become older Christians, they will not depart from it. Do you know some Christians who nobody followed up on them? But after being born again, they start coming to the church. But even though they are hearing the word of God in the church, something is missing. They do not know how to have quiet time, how to wake up in the morning, have quiet. Nobody ever told them. And they live their Christian lives by the grace of God, from what they are hearing in the Bible study, at the Sunday fellowship, at the Thursday meeting. Since they started coming to the church, they are finding their way, and they are trying to plant their feet in the kingdom. And on their own, they will say, by the grace of God, I'm living the life. And they live, they do the best they can, but quiet time is missing. Then one day, maybe 3 years after being born again, and they've been coming to church, there's a message on reading your Bible every day and praying every day. And they hear it now. But remember, he has been a Christian born again child of God for 3 years. He has not been having that regular quiet time. Nobody ever told him. And it's going to have real difficulty, because it's already his habit not to have quiet time. And the quiet time will not be something he can just pick up like that. But if when he was very young, when he was just a day old, a week old, you went to him and you said, you know, there's something called quiet time, a time of quietness, when you shut out all the noise around you, and then you go into the word of God, you just read a few verses. Here is something you can use, we call it daily manna. Here is something you can use higher every day. Here is something you can use, daily bread, whatever. And then he's reading that from that young age. When he just came to know the Lord, he has started a quiet time. You'll find after 10 years in the Lord, he doesn't miss his quiet time, because that's the way he was brought up when he was very, very young. Now, as somebody has just become born again, and then you bring him to church, and they say, if you have anything to offer to the Lord, raise it up. And he just sees other people, he doesn't register on him. And then for 1 year, he's not paying tithe. And for 2 years, he's not paying tithe and offering. And then one day, he hears the word of God concerning that message. You must pay your tithe, because that's the path how God will bless you. And then 1 month he'll remember, the other time he'll not remember, because he wasn't brought up that way. But if when he was very, very young in the Lord, he had been taught, this is a path to the blessing, and this is how to succeed, this is how to have financial prosperity, we give a tithe unto the Lord. As a new convert, he's willing to do anything, he's willing to obey the word of God. And then it grows with him. When he becomes richer, it will not be a difficult thing. That's why we do the follow-up, train up a child the way he should go, and then when he's old, he will not depart from it. Number two, inform. You inform him, temptations will come, trials will come. And it's that information that helps him to be able to, in fact, he's getting ready already, he's saying, no, I'm not going to go back. Whatever temptation, whatever trial, I am going to stand. Because you gave information, number one, instruct, number two, inform. You look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. 1 Thessalonians 3, I'm reading from verse 1. Wherefore, when we could no longer forbear, we thought it good to be left at Athens alone, and sent Timotheus, our brother and minister of God, and a fellow laborer in the gospel of Christ, to establish you. You see that? He sent him to establish these Thessalonian believers, to establish you and to comfort you concerning your faith, that no man should be moved by these afflictions, trials, temptations, persecutions, suffering. For ye yourselves know that we are appointed thereunto. How did we know? In verse 4, for verily, when we were with you, we told you before. We told you before that we should suffer tribulation, even as it came to pass. And ye know. They gave them information, inform them, this is coming. Yeah, everybody likes you now, everybody appreciates you now, but it may come. Get ready. Number three is to instill in the new convert the discipline of quiet time. Instill it into them. instill it into them. You tell them, you know, other converts, you know what they have done, and you wonder why the people, why some people are very strong in the Lord. What they do is they read their Bible and they pray every day. In Acts of the Apostles, chapter 17, verse 11. Acts 17, verse 11. These were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and they searched the scriptures daily. They searched the scriptures daily. They searched the scriptures daily, whether those things were so. And you begin to tell that convert, do you know that some converts are more noble than converts? What makes them noble? Because they search the word. They read the word. They meditate on the word every day, and they pray as well. Numbers 4, you interpret difficult scriptures unto them. Interpret difficult scriptures unto them. As you encourage them to do quiet time, they'll be doing quiet time. And as they do the quiet time, then they will find some things that are very tough and difficult for them to understand. They say, hey, this I don't understand. Because I was reading the Bible, and it says, give unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and then unto God the things that are God's. And the other time after I became born again, when Daddy sent me to go and buy alcohol, and I said, no, Daddy, I'm born again now. I cannot do that. That's the passage of scripture that my daddy quoted for me and said, you are taking this thing too far. You are becoming fanatical. Have you not read in the Bible? Give unto Caesar the things that belong to Caesar. The alcohol belongs to me. You are not the one to drink. Go and buy it for me. And I was confused. I'm glad you came. You see, there are things that may be all right for you that is very clear to you. You understand, but you don't understand. That's the reason why you'll interpret for them the difficult scriptures. Before I come back to that Caesar's issue, let's come to 2 Peter chapter 3. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 16, as also in all his epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to be understood, in which there are some things hard, difficult to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable rest, be twist, as they do also the other scriptures unto their own destruction. So these newcomers, there are people who are ready to twist scriptures for them. And if you don't follow them up and go to them to interpret those difficult scriptures for them, they're going to get confused. Now this convert is asking you, give unto Caesar. Oh, you say, that's very simple. You see, Caesar was the emperor at that time, like president, like head of state, you know, at that time. And the people were supposed to pay their taxes. And so these religious people came to ask Jesus a question. And Jesus said, show me one of your coins. And then they saw the image or the picture of the emperor on their coin. And then Jesus said, pay your taxes. And you see, today we too will pay our tax. And when we pay our tax, we're giving to the government, we're giving to Caesar what belongs to Caesar. But it's not talking about giving them poison or giving them anything that will hurt them or destroy their health. And then that newcomer to say, yes, I now understand. Number 5, integrate the new believer into the fellowship of the church. Integrate them. Integrate them into the fellowship of the church. Acts of the Apostles, we're reading from chapter 9. Acts chapter 9, integrating them to the fellowship of the local church. Acts chapter 9, reading from verse 26. And when Saul was come to Jerusalem, he assayed, he tried to join himself to the disciples, but they were all afraid of him and believed not that he was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and declared unto them how he had seen the Lord in the way, and that he had spoken to him, and how he had preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus, and he was with them, coming in and going out at Jerusalem. That's about Saul of Tarsus, or Paul. He wanted to join himself to the church, and they were suspecting him. They said, no, he just wants to come in here and spy on us. and know the people that are leaders in the church, and then he will use his night to come and persecute us and destroy the church. And when Barnabas saw that, then he took Paul and integrated him with the church. Oh, you say Paul in any case was a strong man. He was a real believer. His own salvation is different from salvation of other people. Even if Barnabas did not come to introduce him, that man will still stand. Ah, you think so? Listen to this. You see, those apostles in Jerusalem, they were the people that were the real foundation members of the church. They were the pillars of the church. Even Paul the apostle said so. What if Paul just said, I don't care about them. I don't want to be integrated with the church. I'll just keep on preaching. They'll oppose him in Jerusalem. They'll say, no, he's not a real convert. We have not accepted him. He came over here. We rejected him. And then he began to write epistles. They will not put his epistles in the canon of the scriptures. They will say, no, and that's just a religious man, especially because now he's even saying that circumcision is not acceptable. Didn't we tell you this man is not real? Didn't we tell you that this man is not genuine? He's destroying what we are preaching in Jerusalem here. But you know, when Barnabas came, he saw that they were not accepting him. And in his follow-up, he took him, integrated him with the church. Now they accepted him. He was going out and in with them. And later, anything he did for the Lord was accepted, was approved in Jerusalem. All those epistles he wrote, they were also accepted and approved in Jerusalem. That's how you have all these things in the scriptures. It's very important that we do this follow-up very well. Number six is to influence them. Influence them with positive example. You see, your example matters a lot, and it is your example that you influence other people with the word of God. In 1 Timothy chapter 4 verse 12, let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example to believers, especially these young converts, new believers. Be an example to them in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity. So you are to be an example to them, influencing them. Then number seven, inspire the new believer. Inspire the new believer. So that this new believer, as you are working for the Lord, he also be able to work for the Lord, discovering his own God-given potentials. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 2, for I know the forwardness of your mind, for which I boast of you to them of Macedonia, and that Achaia was ready a year ago, your zeal has provoked very many. Your zeal has inspired very many. Your zeal has stirred up very many. That's what we need to do, that you will be zealous in the things of the Lord as you are following up on those new converts, and then your zeal will inspire them, influence them to be who they ought to be. If that is the purpose, how about the practice? Let's go to point number two, the practice of follow-up and visitation. The practice of follow-up and visitation. Let's come back again to Acts of the Apostles chapter 15. The practice of follow-up and visitation. Acts chapter 15, we're looking at verse 36. Acts 15, verse 36. And some days after, Paul said unto Barnabas, let us go again. Let us go again. It's wonderful when two of us can go together to visit those converts. Let us go, not let me go. Excuse me, I want to go and do visitation. Pick a Barnabas. And if Barnabas is not willing to go because of one problem or the other, Silas is there. And then Paul and Silas can go together. Let there be two of you, two sisters together, or two brothers together. That's the practice of those days. That's still the practice today. Do you remember Peter and John going to Samaria? That's follow up. And now Paul and Silas, that's follow up. And Jesus chose them two by two. That's a very good principle. It says, let us go and visit our brethren in every city. In every city, you'll be so faithful that when either we have a great crusade and then many people came to know the Lord, and now you have been given some cards, can we follow people that we were not those who brought them to the Lord. Of course, yes. Because Silas was not involved in the missionary journey, in the missionary team, and in the evangelism. But now he was going with Paul to follow up on those people. And then it says that we go again and visit our brethren in every city. Don't miss out anyone where we have preached the word of the Lord and see how they do. And then let's look at the example of the Lord Jesus Christ in John chapter 9. John chapter 9, I'm reading from verse 34. John chapter 9, verse 34. In John chapter 9, verse 34, they answered and said unto him, thou wast altogether born in sins, dost thou teach us? And they cast him out. Here is somebody that just believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, and what did they do to him? They cast him out of the synagogue. They will not accept him in their fellowship anymore, because he was saying that this Jesus is the perfect one. He opened my eyes. I believe in him. He is my Lord. And then they say, are you trying to teach us? They cast him out. Verse 35, Jesus heard that they had cast him out. Do you hear any information about those new converts? What's happening in their place of work? What's happening in their school? What's happening in their class? What's happening in their family? Jesus heard that he cast him out. And when he had found him, if he didn't look for him, he'll not find him. You look for them. They're going through persecution. And they're casting them out of their club, of their society, of their home, of their school, of their local church where they were before. And they feel the greatest calamity has happened unto them, because they threw them out. Jesus found him out and knew that they had cast him out. And then we are told, he said, dost thou believe on the Son of God? Do you still believe? Even though you are suffering like this, you have been misinterpreted and mishandled and mistreated, do you still believe on the Lord? Jesus said unto him, then he said, who is he, Lord, that I might believe? Jesus said unto him, thou hast both seen him, and it is he that talketh with thee. And he says, Lord, I believe. And he worshipped him. You see that kind of a follow-up. And then we're looking at Acts chapter 11. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 11, verse 25 and verse 26. Acts 11, verse 25. Then departed Barnabas to Tarsus for to seek Saul. And you see, this is repeated visitation. Because we have read in chapter 9, when he came to Jerusalem, it was Barnabas that made him to be integrated to the church. But after that, Paul did not remain in Jerusalem. Then he was in safe hands, good hands. He had gone back to Tarsus. And then Barnabas, we are told, again went to Tarsus to seek Saul. Some of the new converts, you know, they don't remain with us in the city. They don't remain with us in our local church. They don't remain with us at the central church, at the Jerusalem church. And then you find out, where has he gone? He's a new convert. I cannot leave him like that. I must follow up on him. And then when you hear where they have gone, maybe through their telephone number or contact address, whatever, you reach out after them and you bring them again. In verse 26, and when he had found him, he sought for him, and now he found him. He brought him unto Antioch. And it came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people. And the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. Actually, Barnabas took him, he brought him near. And then every time he went to church, he took Paul with him. Every time he was going, he'll branch out his place and take him with him. Do you do that? That's what we need to do in our follow-up system. Now, there are times when in following up, we cannot do it directly ourselves. What do we do? Let's look at Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, verse 19. In Philippians chapter 2, reading from verse 19, but I trust in the Lord, in the Lord Jesus, to send Timotheus shortly unto you, that I also may be of good comfort when I know your state. Paul the Apostle said, I should really come to you myself, you Philippians. Because you remember Philippi, that's where that damsel was following after Paul and Silas. These are the men of God that show unto us the way of salvation. Do you remember Philippi? That's where the Philippian jailer was converted. Do you remember Philippi? That's where the prison doors were opened. And all those prisoners, they heard how they sang. And then many of them had come to know the Lord. A church had been established there. And Paul, the apostle, was thinking, I ought to go back there. I ought to go back there. But things were very loaded and busy for him. Because of that, he couldn't go. Then he said, I'm sending Timothy to you. And Timothy himself was a pastor in the church at Ephesus. And even though he was a pastor there, he said, Timothy, you are not as busy as I am. Please, you'll go to Philippi on my behalf. What am I telling you? You know, I have some cards, and I happen to be a group coordinator. And then because of my, you know, they put me in the vetting committee, and they put me in the marriage committee, and they put me in this and that, and I see that the time is going. And then I say, please come, coordinator, I have this card. I really would like to do it myself. But you see, I have to be here and here and there. Get this card, follow up this person on my behalf. We do that, we ought to do that. And so that those people do not miss out, Paul the apostle actually sent Timothy in 1 Corinthians chapter 4. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, I'm reading verse 17. For this cause have I sent unto you Timotheus, who is my beloved son and faithful in the Lord, who shall bring you into remembrance of my ways, which be in Christ, as I teach everywhere in every church. Here is another thing now. We need to be very, very careful. What do I mean by this? You are supposed to follow up somebody, but you don't have the time. And then you are calling somebody, and again, you pounce on Timothy. You have sent Timothy to Philippi. He has come back and is giving you a good report. You say, Timothy, I know you are a pastor, and I know you are pastoring the church at Ephesus. I need your attention again. Please, you will go to Corinth. You know, there are some Timothys that will say, it looks like, because I always say yes, I always say I agree, I always say I'm available. This man doesn't know I'm a pastor to you. Even though you are apostle as well as pastor and evangelist, I'm also a pastor to you. And if I'm neglecting my church in Ephesus, how will it be? But you know, Timothy never did that. Follow-up is so important. And that means, of course, Paul could have sent another person. But he didn't, because he trusted Timothy. And he said, it is Timothy that will do it. Of course, he also said to other people, 2 Corinthians chapter 7. In 2 Corinthians chapter 7, I'm reading to you from verse 6. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 6. Nevertheless, God that comforteth those that are cast down, comforted us by the coming of Titus. Here is another person that Paul sent whenever he couldn't do it directly himself. You should have brothers and sisters cooperating with you, walking along with you, that you will not say, because you are too busy, this fellow will not be followed up. Give the car to a trusted sister. Give it to a trusted brother who can do the follow up alongside with you. Verse 13. In verse 13, this is 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 13. Therefore, we were comforted in your comfort, yea, and exceedingly the more joyed, we for the joy of Titus, because his spirit was refreshed by you all. Then in verse 14, for if I have boasted anything to him of you, I am not ashamed. But as we speak all things to you in truth, even so our boasting which I made before Titus is found to be true. And then it says, and his inward affection is more abundant toward you, while he remembereth the obedience of you all, how with fear and trembling you received him. I rejoice therefore that I have confidence in you in all things. Titus came back and gave a report and said, those converts, they're standing. They're not backsliding. They're remaining in the Lord and of the Lord. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, I'm reading to you again from verse 2, and sent Timotheus, our brother and minister of God and a fellow laborer in the gospel, to establish you and to comfort you concerning your faith. Here is Timothy again. He sent him again. We're learning something here, that even though you are a busy minister yourself and a busy worker yourself, and in the section where you are working for the Lord, you are productive and you are nice and you are good and you are needed there. But there are times, if the Lord is too heavy for some of us, we can call you. You are our Timothy. You go to Corinth. And then when you go back, okay, go and visit your church in Ephesus. Now, Timothy, you're being some time in Ephesus now. We need your attention in Philippi again. And then you are sent to Philippi. And then after you come back from Philippi, go back to your church in Ephesus and go and do the great work, the good work you're doing there. After some time, you know, Timothy, I need your attention again. And I'm going to send you to Thessalonica. And what a wonderful thing. Timothy never said no to Paul the Apostle. Never. Never said no. Yes, he had a great work, and he had a good work that was doing in Ephesus. And you know, Timothy was not really a strong person, a dynamic person, because Paul had to be telling Timothy that God has not given him the spirit of fear. He had challenges in the church in Ephesus. There were some older believers in the church in Ephesus that were saying, this young fellow. That's why Paul the Apostle said, let no man despise thy youth. Some people were looking down on him, belittling him. He could have thought, Paul, you know my challenges here. You know my difficulties here. And you know the load of work on me at the church in Ephesus here. And you know these people are saying that I'm a little bit timid. I'm not doing all my work. And you are getting me out every time of my church location, sending me here, sending me here, sending me here to do the follow-up. Why don't you do your follow-up yourself? Never, Timothy. He just accepted God has appointed Paul over me as my leader. He needs to follow up these people. I know he doesn't have the time. He needs my attention. I will go on his behalf. I pray God will make you like that. Amen. See, that's effective follow-up. It must begin immediately. The new convert comes to the Lord. Now, let me summarize that point two before I go to point number three. How do we actually do this follow-up? What are the ingredients and the components of this follow-up? Number one, persistent prayer. We've seen enough of that already in the epistles of Paul the Apostle. Persistent prayer. Number two, personal contact. We're personally contacting them. We ought to, we must, and we must do it with urgency. Number three, purposeful correspondence. There are times you write to them. And Paul the Apostle will write to those new converts. And in this day of modern technology, we can use a telephone, we can use the email, we can use all the gadgets that are now available. Number four, profitable Christian literature. Profitable Christian literature. There may be tracts, there may be books, there may be daily reading material that we're sending to them. Maybe a good Bible with a good concordance. We decide to buy for them so that they'll be able to grow and develop. Number five, pertinent, that means appropriate, audio tapes. Pertinent, that means appropriate audio tapes. You are sending it to them, or it may be CD that you are sending to them. But let me warn you, we know that some CDs of drama and this and that are going all around. Don't send that kind of thing to new converts. You know, all those things, they are filled with just, additions and subtractions and this and that. And many times when you see those pictures, you remember the pictures more than the materials there. More than the thing they are trying to pass across, get them rooted in the scriptures. Get them rooted in the word of God. And they know that actually what we're hearing from these audio tapes or CD or DVD is actually the word of God. Number six, persuaded and persuasive representatives, like Timothy, like Titus, like all the others, persuaded. These representatives have persuaded themselves that they ought to do the follow-up. And not only that they are persuaded, they are persuasive representatives. Number seven, passionate, patient Christians. Passionate, patient Christians. Not somebody that will beat them on the head and drive them and tell them you're too slow, you're not growing, and then they destroy those new converts. They must be passionate, patient believers, Christians. I come to point number three. Profitable, the profit of follow-up and visitation. The profit of follow-up and Visitation. What's the profit if we actually do the follow-up? And then let's come to John chapter 5. John chapter 5. I'm reading from verse 14. John chapter 5, verse 14. Afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple, and said unto him, Behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest a worse sin come unto thee. That's follow up. The Lord had been a blessing to him already. He had been healed. And now the Lord said, You have been made whole. He found him. Again, if he wasn't looking for him, there are many people in the temple. But Jesus knew, that man that I healed, he went to him and he said, I want to tell you something. You need follow up. And now I'm telling you in this follow up to develop you and to groom you and to make you develop. See no more, lest a worse thing happen unto you. Acts of the Apostles chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 41 and verse 42. Acts chapter 2 verse 41. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized. And the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, and in fellowship, and in breaking of bread, and in prayers. You see, that is the prophet. They continued. They became part of the church. And then we're told in Acts chapter 9. Acts chapter 9, I'm reading from verse 10. Acts chapter 9, verse 10. And there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias. And he said, Behold, here am I, Lord. And the Lord said unto him, Arise and go into the street which is called Straight, and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus, for behold, he prays. Now this Saul had been born again. How do we know he's born again? Look at verse 17. And Ananias went his way and entered into the house, putting his hands on him, said, Brother Saul. Before he got there, the man had been born again already. And even though he was not instrumental to his being born again, he was not instrumental to Saul being born again. The Lord Jesus Christ met him by the way. And then that man yielded to the Lord and became born again. And then the Lord said, he became born again through me. But you are the one to do follow up. You know, there are people that may have a wrong attitude. Well, they have done the preaching, and those people have come to the Lord. If they want to finish their work, let them do the follow up themselves. It doesn't always work that way. Jesus confronted that man on the way to Damascus. He became born again, Brother Saul. And yet the same Lord Jesus told Ananias, I brought him to myself, you do the follow-up. And so then, when we have the great miracle crusade or the great resurrection transformation crusade, and then the cards are given to you, you will not say, no, they did the preaching. Let them do the follow-up themselves. We have done the preaching, and those people have come to know the Lord. It's now in your hand. You go and do the follow-up. And then we're told from verse 20, and straightway he preached Christ in the synagogues, that he is the Son of God. And but all that heard him were amazed, and said, Is not this he that destroyed them which called on this name in Jerusalem, and came hither for that intent, that he might bring them bound unto the chief priests? But Saul increased the more in strength, and confounded the Jews which dwelt at Damascus, proving that this is the very Christ. And after many days were fulfilled, the Jews took counsel to kill him. But the laying await was known of Saul, and they watched the gates day and night to kill him. Then the disciples took him by night, and let him down by a wall in a basket. Do you see that protection? It's part of the follow-up. And if they didn't follow up, if they said the man is strong already, he's even quoting scriptures now. And he's even preaching in the synagogue now. When he got into this trouble, if they all abandoned him and they were not following up on him, he could have lost his life. But because they were following up and they were looking at every stage and everything happening to him, and when his life was in danger, these people doing the follow up, then they sent him out of town. And then we now read from verse 26 to verse 28, when he got to Jerusalem, again, he needed follow up. You know, Barnabas could have said, he has been known of the Christians in Damascus, and information lies very quick. And everybody knows that the man is born again, and they know that he's preaching the message now in Damascus. No, they still kept on following him up in those initial years, and that's what we need to do. We'll do it in Jesus' name. And then as we look at the word of God, we're looking at Acts chapter 18. We read it before. Let's read it again. Acts chapter 18, verse 23. Acts 18, verse 23. And after he had spent some time there, he departed and went over all the country of Galatia and Phrygia in order, strengthening all the disciples. That's what he did, and the disciples became stronger because of that follow up. And the Lord is calling us to do it, and we're going to do it. In Romans chapter 1, verse 11. Romans chapter 1, verse 11. For I long to see you, that I might impart unto you some spiritual gifts, to the end ye may be established. That's the prophet of follow-up, they become established. In verse 12, that is, that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith, both of you and me. It even strengthens the believer who is doing the follow-up as well. And then we'll look at 1 Thessalonians. In 1 Thessalonians, I'm reading from chapter 2. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, reading from verse 7. But who were gentle among you, even as a nurse cherishes her children. That's how we ought to do the follow-up. These are children. These are newcomers. These are babes in Christ. And you'll be gentle among those newcomers. And you'll be nursing them, cherishing them. You'll appreciate them. And you will make them to feel very important. You'll rejoice with any little discovery they make in the word of God. It may look ordinary to you. It says, I thank God you came. I was reading something in the Bible this morning, and you think it's going to be a great, great revelation. And it says, I saw this in the word of God, and it points to the verse, and it's a very common verse to you. You must rejoice with him. This is a new discovery, because this is a little child, and this is a little babe, and you are cherishing and nourishing him as a little babe. So being affectionately desirous of you, we were willing to have imparted unto you not only the gospel of God only, but also our own souls, because you are dear unto us. When you follow up, you will not go with a tired look, a tired voice, a tired, worn-out personality, as if they gave me the card, and what can I do? If I don't come now, I'll be feeling guilty. Be excited. Let this fellow know that he's very precious and very dear unto you, and you cherish them and you nourish them, and you're doing it with all joy and happiness. Then he tells us in verse 9, for ye remember, brethren, our labor and travail, for laboring night and day, because we will not be chargeable unto any of you. Not chargeable unto any of you. When you go to visit the new converts, you'll not, when you finish, you'll not say, I would need some money for my transportation. It's just, self-denial that makes me to come here. Actually, I'm very, very busy, and at this time now, I don't have any money with me. And then you will give me some money so I can use it for a taxi or for a bus or something. Not chargeable to any of you. You're not putting the load of your responsibility on them. It's like, a mother telling the child to go and work because, if I'm going to feed you, you must work. Or like the father saying, if I'm going to pay your school fees, you must work. It's a little child, and you are to give everything you have sacrificially so you can really follow up, and I know we're going to do it. He said, we preach the gospel of God unto you, and ye are witnesses, and God also, how holily and justly and unblameably we behaved ourselves among you that believe. As we come to a conclusion of our Bible study today, what are we learning? We consider and we become committed, number one, to the vision. Number two, to the value. Number three, to visitation. Number four, to the variety. Number five, to the vigilance. And then number six, to the virtue. Number seven, to the vow. Number one, you become committed to the vision of follow-up. The vision of follow-up. Follow-up is so essential. Follow-up is so important. And without vision, the people perish. In Proverbs chapter 29. Proverbs chapter 29. I'm reading from verse 18. Proverbs chapter 29, verse 18. Where there is no vision, the people perish. If as a church, we do quite a lot of evangelism and quite a lot of crusades and quite a lot of moving up and moving down, going there and going there, and we bring a lot of people to the Lord, but we don't have the vision for follow up, the people will perish. Where there's no vision, the people perish. Number two, we become committed to the value of follow up. Follow up is very valuable. And then as we see the value of follow-up, we become committed to it. Acts of the Apostles chapter 2. Acts of the Apostles chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 42. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. That's the value of follow-up. They came to know the Lord. And these believers, these apostles, will not leave them alone because of the value of follow-up. And then it says, and they continue in doctrine and fellowship, in breaking bread and in prayers. Number three, we are committed to the follow-up, and then visitation in follow-up. To the visitation in follow-up. James chapter 1, verse 27. James chapter 1, verse 27. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and the widows in their afflictions and to keep himself unspotted from the world. You are committed to the visitation. It's part of your program. It's not something you will do when you feel happy or when you feel strong. It's like it's part of your timetable. It's part of your schedule. Because you know the importance, you have the vision, you have the value, and then you have the visitation. Number four, you are committed to the variety of follow-up methods. You are committed to the variety of follow-up methods. You are not just sticking with just one method. You know different methods will reach different people. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, I'm reading from verse 22. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 22, to the weak became I as weak, that I might gain the weak. I have made all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. That I might by all means save some. That means then the varieties are there. Some you just telephone them. Some you have to write to them. Some you have to see them face to face. Some you have to go with another person. Some you have to be very, very patient. Some, you know, you are getting them up, they are going back, you are getting them up, they are going back. And then you are persistent and you are patient with them. Variety of follow-up methods. Number five, vigilance in follow-up. That's your commitment. You come vigilant. You are watching over those people. And if any false prophet will go there, any confusionist will go there, you are very, very sharp because you are committed in vigilance. In Proverbs chapter 27, verse 23. Proverbs 27, verse 23. Be thou diligent to know the state of thy flocks and look well to thy herd. Very, very diligent to know the state of thy flocks, of the people you are following up. Number six, the virtue during follow-up. Your virtue during follow-up. It may so happen that maybe there's no way you could have passed the card of that lady to another sister. Sometimes it happens like that, and you are a man, but you keep your virtue during that follow-up. Or maybe you are a lady, and there are two ladies, you know, there are two sisters, and you just have to see this young man, but you keep your virtue at that time. Or maybe you are an unemployed person, and you are given the card of a person who is a manager, a director, who easily can employ somebody. And that time you have to be very careful and keep your virtue as you are doing the follow-up. It may be that there is your colleague in the place of work. He has come to know the Lord and, you know, he has that same address. And you are following up on the person. And you keep your dignity, you keep your integrity, you keep your life and your Christian life. You do not pollute yourself. It may be that, the fellow has been on drugs, has been in prostitution or whatever, and now you are doing the follow-up. You make sure you keep your virtue at that time of follow-up. Second Peter, I'm reading to you from chapter 1 and from verse 3. Second Peter, chapter 1, verse 3. According as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and to godliness through the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and virtue. Keep that virtue. Keep that virtue during the time of follow-up. Verse 5, and beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue knowledge. Make sure you're keeping that virtue. And then now the vow of follow-up. In Psalm 76, the vow of follow-up. You have heard all that Jesus did. You have heard all that Paul did. You have heard all that Timothy did. You have heard all that the other people, the believers in the early church, what they did. And then you are making a commitment. You are making a vow. You are making a consecration. You are saying, if they did it, I will do it. This is our own time. And these new converts are there, and we're going to follow up on them. You make a vow before the Lord in Psalm 76, verse 11. Vow and pay unto the Lord your God. Let all that be round about him bring presents unto him that ought to be feared. Bring presents. The present you are bringing now is this soul. You have the card, you have the name, you have the contact address. He has given himself to the Lord, and you want to present him on the final day before the Lord. And the vow you are making is this new convert that has not come to know the Lord, either through me or through you or through our brother there, through our sister there, or through the crusade or through our soul-winning evangelistic outreach in our district or zone. Now you have the contact, and you are the one to do the follow-up, and you want to present this soul eventually unto the Lord as a person that you want to the Lord, we want to the Lord, and we're keeping in the Lord. I pray you will keep them, and they will not be lost. And on the final day, according to your consecration, commitment, and vow, they'll be with the Lord and be with us together in Jesus' name. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer. The vision of follow-up, the value of follow-up, the visitation in follow-up, the variety of follow-up methods, vigilance in follow-up, virtue while we're following up, and the vow of follow-up. Why don't you talk to the Lord and say, Lord, I will do it. I've heard your word. I commit myself to you, and it will be done. I will do it. We're evangelizing. We need to go beyond evangelizing and then go to enlighten those converts. Encourage them to endure. Thank God you are standing because other people helped you. Other people invested in you. Do you remember what Bibles other people bought for you when you were born again? Do you remember books that other people offered you when you were born again? Do you remember the encouragement other people gave you when you were born again? Do you remember how other people brought you to the church when you were born again? Do you remember how they encouraged you when you were born again? It was the fellowship, the support, the prayer, the encouragement of the brethren that didn't allow the persecution you suffered at that time to blow you away, to blow you off your feet. Now by God's grace, you are standing. Now you are strong. Now you are steadfast. Now nobody needs to run after you before you come to church. It has become your habit to love the Lord, to serve the Lord. Every day now, you rejoice in the service of the Lord. It's because other people encouraged you. It's now your turn to encourage other people. Follow them up until they are born again. After they are born again, keep on exhorting them, instructing them, teaching them. But make sure you exemplify your teaching. Exemplify the doctrine. Exemplify the exhortation. Exemplify the instruction you are giving them. Edify them. Don't tell them about your problems. That will not edify them. Don't tell them about the difficult time you are having with so and so. That will not edify them. If you happen to have any disagreement with your fellow brother, fellow sister, don't discuss that with new converts. That will not edify them. Don't ever talk about your problems before a new convert. That will not edify him or her. Let him just see you as a strong, happy, joyful believer. Cast your burdens on the Lord. Don't cast your burdens on the new convert. And while you are following up on those new converts, the Lord will take care of your problems. Get them engaged. Engage them. Take them out with you to evangelize. Pray together with them. Read the Bible, study the Bible with them. Bring them to the Bible study. Bring them to the Sunday fellowship with you. Get them engaged. Tell the Lord that this vision of follow-up will not die in your heart. Pray that the Lord will help you be a burning flame, a burning fire, that there be real vision. Where there's no vision, the people perish. If we only have vision for evangelism without vision for follow-up, the people will perish. If we have vision for crusade, immediately after the last day of the crusade, we're tired and we don't do follow-up, the people will perish. A vision for follow-up. Understand the value of follow-up. The value of follow-up. The profit in follow-up. If you value something, you'll give it time. You always have time for what you value. And the amount of time you give to something shows the value you place on that thing. The sacrifice you're willing to give for something shows the value you put on it. Let's put some value on follow-up. And spend time. And give of your resources to actually do the follow-up. Value it. You are committed to visitation. You're not expecting that they will come to you. You are going to them. You are contacting them. You are calling them. You are knocking on their doors. Visitation. And follow up.